Thank you. Thanks everyone for joining my talk today. My name is Hannah Kerner, and I'm an assistant research professor at the University of Maryland, where I work on the NASA Harvest research team for agricultural monitoring from satellite data. So here I will share my screen. Uh-oh, sneak peek. Okay, there we go. Hopefully everyone can see this. So in this talk, I'm going to be talking about how NASA Harvest is using satellite data to monitor agriculture at the field scale using machine learning and new data sources. So why do we want to monitor agriculture? One reason we might want to do this is to estimate crop production and other agricultural monitoring variables, both domestically and internationally. So you can see here in this figure that the highest errors for forecasting agriculture productivity happen before harvest. So in the months leading up to harvest at the end of the year. And so this is really where the opportunity window is for Earth observation data to provide information about agricultural systems before crops are harvested. We also want to inform and stabilize markets. So commodities are traded and purchased based on agricultural productivity estimates. For example, here, this figure shows major fluctuations in the average price of maize in the United States last year in 2019, which were where there was uncertainty due to extreme weather and policy changes around the US-China trade war. We also want to anticipate food crises and be able to deliver aid proactively. This is one example from our work in Uganda, where the Commissioner Office of the Prime Minister, Martin Owar, noted that in the past, they had always been reacting to crop failure, spending billions of shillings to provide food aid in the region. But in 2017, working with NASA Harvest on our crop monitor program, they were able to actually proactively determine where aid needed to be delivered because they had evidence from satellite data early on. So this resulted in hundreds of thousands of people helped and millions of dollars in savings. We may also want to use satellite data to inform insurance programs around agriculture. This image here shows some flooded croplands in Iowa, again during the 2019 season in the United States, where we had the wettest spring on record that caused enormous flooding in the Midwest during the planting season. And then finally, we want to monitor and meet the Sustainable Development Goals from the UN. So here I've put a star on all of the SDGs that are directly related to agriculture from my point of view. And you can see that agriculture reaches almost every one of the SDGs. So NASA has been using satellite data to monitor agricultural systems as far back as the 1970s. And this is really started with this program AgriStars that was using remote sensing data to monitor agriculture. But despite over 40 years of having used satellite data for agricultural monitoring, we still haven't really realized the full potential of remote sensing for agriculture. But today, we're really finally in a unique situation where we're enabled by machine learning, as well as modern compute capabilities, including the availability of GPUs that have also enabled machine learning, and additionally new data sources from remote sensing to actually realize this potential for agriculture. So why do we need to use machine learning for satellite data? I kind of wanted to talk about this at the beginning of the satellite data session. So for machine learning is really able, it's sort of a perfect storm for satellite data. So in satellite data, Earth observation, we have huge data volumes. For example, from one data source alone, Planet Labs, we have 11 terabytes of data per day of the planet. And these data are very high dimensional. So they're not only large spatially, but they also have multispectral and hyperspectral channels oftentimes that are seeing beyond the visible and even beyond optical bands. We also have frequent revisit times. So we have a temporal dimension as well. So Landsat, which is sort of the workhorse satellite from the United States, revisits the same spot on Earth every 16 days. And Sentinel-2, which is the European Space Agency equivalent to Landsat effectively, Sentinel-2 revisits the same location every 5 days. And again, Planet Labs is revisiting the same location nearly daily or even sub-daily in some places. So we have a huge amount of data from these satellite data sources. And then finally, this is challenging to do because it's non-trivial to interact with remote sensing data and to pre-process this data before feeding it to our machine learning models. So unlike commonly used data sets like ImageNet or even just normal sort of 8-bit images that we might be used to interacting with, satellite data are much more complex, including the need to remove clouds, process images to be geo-referenced over the same location, and things like this to prepare the data. So in this GIF here, I'm actually showing the actual unprocessed time series for one band that we get from the harmonized Landsat Sentinel-2 data set. So all of these blank pixels that you're seeing are where there's no data because the satellite track is only covering part of this tile, or there are clouds. So you can see there's a lot of pre-processing that we need to do as well to prepare these data for machine learning. So in agricultural monitoring, typically the tasks we want to do using satellite data are to estimate production, forecast yields, estimate conditions, crop conditions, detect diseases and pests, and prescribe inputs or farming practices to farmers. And really at the core of all of this is something called crop type mapping, where before we can make any assessments about how a crop might be performing, for example, we need to know where that crop is planted and which crop is planted. So crop type mapping consists of estimating in every pixel or in every unit of area, what type of crop is planted and if a crop is planted. And so this is really the core of my research with machine learning. So I'm going to talk about a couple of different examples of how we are doing crop type mapping globally at the field scales at NASA Harvest. And one of these is for in-season crop type mapping. So that the idea here is that, again, we have the highest uncertainty about crop production during the growing season. And this is especially exacerbated in anomalous years. So I mentioned in 2019, we had this record flooding that caused 1 to 2 months planting delays in many areas in the Midwest. And in 2020, not only are we actually expecting a wet spring again, but we also will have USDA surveys being delayed due to COVID-19 travel restrictions. So we really have a need to be able to map out where these different types of crops are planted as early as possible during a growing season. So our goal here is to map these crop types as well as the planting timelines using satellite data and machine learning. In this project, we're using the harmonized Landsat and Sentinel-2 data set, which effectively merges the Landsat and Sentinel-2 sensors so that we can treat them as one data stream. So this data set is at a 30 meter per pixel resolution. So each pixel represents a 30 by 30 meter area on the ground. There's a 3 to 5 day revisit time, and these data are multispectral. So we have information from the visible to the shortwave infrared. We actually have thermal infrared from Landsat as well, but Sentinel does not have that. And these data are freely available to the public, currently for all of North America and some other regions, but HLS is being processed globally by the end of the year. And the labels that we use to train our machine learning methods come from what's called the USDA cropland data layer. So the USDA puts out this product every year in February-ish after harvest, so a few months after harvest, mapping out where all of these different types of crops were planted. And this has the same resolution as the Landsat satellite and our HLS data set. So you can see this big cluster of corn and soybeans here in the Midwest or in the Corn Belt. And the machine learning method that we use to do this is a combination of deep learning methods that are recurrent and convolutional. So first, what we do to prepare the satellite data for the machine learning model is to extract observations that correspond to key phenological stages for the crops. So we first, looking at this time series of essentially the greenness, we can look at where is the crop increasing in greenness the most, the green up period, when is it at its peak growth, and when is it senescing or starting to dry out before harvest. And we do this so that we can compare the inputs at the same growth stage rather than necessarily the same point in time, which makes us robust to planting delays. And then we give both the temporal and spectral dimension and the spatial and spectral dimension to a recurrent neural network branch called a long short-term memory network and a convolutional branch in order to make our classifications of corn or soybean or other. And then when we do this, using at different times in the season, we have access to just the green up information or the green up and peak or the green or all three dates, we can get a map of where corn and soy are planted. So here you can see our predicted map as of October in the season, as well as in this third column, our predicted map much earlier in June, which is towards the very beginning of the season. And so you can see that our estimates will improve throughout the season, but we can get a pretty good estimate as early as June as well. And so we'll be using this method in the upcoming 2020 season to map crop types in the Midwest. The next project I want to talk about is our work in conflict areas and specifically Mali, where there's low food security due to conflict and instability in this region. And our primary partner on this work is the USAID Bureau for Food Security, who is increasingly implementing agriculture-focused development programs in Mali and other conflict areas in order to improve the resiliency of farming practices. And so traditionally, the way they would evaluate these programs is to conduct household surveys to ask the farmers about their crop productivity and what they planted. However, in Mali, it is currently too dangerous to conduct these field surveys on the ground, even for locals. And so instead, what we are doing is inferring these agricultural monitoring variables from the satellite data rather than needing to go on the ground to visit these farms. And here on the right, you can see the kind of data that we're looking at to do this. So this is a time lapse of Planet Labs images, which are 3 meter, an order of magnitude higher resolution than Landsat, 3 meter per pixel resolution. And you can see in this time lapse, some of these dates in the growing season are just a couple of days apart. So we're able to see these really rapid changes occurring. And our data for these regions where we don't have these federal campaigns to produce crop type masks for previous seasons, we actually go out to the field and collect these data ourselves. So we have a partnership with USAID for this, as well as with Lutheran World Relief, who has collected some of these crop types. Did I just hear something on the call? Nope. Okay. And so here you can see sort of what these boundaries look like. And then we use semi-supervised machine learning methods to allow us to learn from both unlabeled data and the labeled examples, since we have an abundance of unlabeled data, but relatively few labels of fields. And then we can additionally use this to actively select areas where we might need to visit in the future to improve the classification accuracy of our algorithms. And finally, I think I'm sort of at the end of my time here. So I'm just going to briefly say that we can also use satellite data to support farm insurance programs. And we've been working with Swiss Re and the Swiss Re Foundation to improve insurance programs both in the Ukraine for optimizing the number of crop cuts that need to be made when insurance companies visit fields, as well as in Kenya and Mexico to do mapping of agricultural variables from satellite data. So in conclusion, it is a really exciting time for satellite-based agricultural monitoring. And today we really have the combination of methods, compute, and data to realize the potential of satellite-based agricultural monitoring. And what we're doing at NASA Harvest is really to build on this progress of decades of investment by NASA, international community, and the private sector to realize the uptake of satellite data for agricultural monitoring globally. Thank you, and I'm happy to take any questions if we have time.
Great, that was an incredible presentation, Hannah. So just to remind the audience, you can use the Q&A function or you can chat questions in. We do have a few that are lined up. One question just to get things started, Hannah, you spoke about this proliferation of public and private satellite sensors that kind of circumnavigate the globe on a daily and weekly basis. Have you seen anything that's making all this data more readily analyzable? Maybe you can talk about some improvements in that area.
Yeah, that's a great question. As I said, these data are very difficult to deal with and they're also very large. So you don't want to download a ton of data that may not necessarily be exactly what you want, or it's also very difficult to kind of search for what you want within this data. So there's been new standards that have been created over the last several years, such as the STACK framework, that allows for easier searching of satellite data and for standardizing formats for storing these data. There have also been a lot of open source tools that have been developed for interacting with these data more efficiently, as well as cloud-based repositories that are being hosted for free by several cloud providers to make these public data sets more accessible on the cloud.
That's terrific. STACK is a really interesting and great development. So I'm just gonna read a few of the questions that are queued up and I'll read them in a group and then we'll go back to Hannah. So one is from Akshay. The question is, does synthetic aperture radar tie into your work? Since in tropical countries such as Mali, oftentimes cloud cover during crop harvest season gets in the way of collection. A second question from Marcelo, and in spite of being satellite images, could you explain how deep is the data mapping? I mean, are the raw and pre-processing, or can they also be pre-processed data? Why don't I throw those over to you, those two questions over to you, Hannah? You may also be able to see those in your Q&A.
Okay, I don't immediately see. Oh, I see. Okay. Yes, so synthetic aperture radar or SAR data very much ties into what we do. I didn't present on that in this talk because it's really in early stages of development for our work right now. However, we are working on integrating these data. not just in tropical areas where we have rainy seasons that cover have a lot of cloud cover, but even in areas where you might not think it would be as critical, like even in the United States, it's really useful for separating differences that might be due to texture, for example, or soil moisture. So that is something we're working on, and especially we're working on figuring out how best to translate SAR data and optical data into sort of a directly comparable unit where we can truly use SAR data to fill in optical data, for example. And then this question of satellite images, I'm not sure I really understand the question. Maybe the question is around privacy of satellite data and the data that are collected, where yes, privacy is very much an issue where we want to be sure to protect the identities of not just the people collecting the data and where they're visiting, but also to protect any additional information such as productivity or yields or other things that might compromise personal security or privacy. And so it's an ongoing conversation about how we treat this problem generally. We talk to a lot of farmers and farmer organizations directly to try to come up with more generalizable guidelines around privacy. But we also just treat this data very securely, as you would any other personally identifiable information.